And we come now to the last presentation of the session. And I should also say that the young man you see here, this is not Professor Schubert. Schubert could not make it here, but he was sending one of his young colleagues. So this is Professor Gottschalt. And he's a polymer chemist, and he will speak. I assume the topic, the title stayed the same. And I should say that also in Jena, where he's coming from, we have a center on polymers for nanocarriers, but they focus more on inflammation. But I think inflammation is something which also has various similarities to a tumor or to the immune system plays a great role.
Yes. Please. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. As already said, I have the honor to substitute Professor Schubert today here and the honor to give the last talk in the session. And Professor Schubert asked me to show you something about the mentioned center, which started last year. The name is polymer-based nanoparticle libraries for targeted anti-inflammatory strategies. And just to give you some impression, we focused on polymer nanoparticles in this, when we focus on polymer nanoparticles in this center, because as you heard already, you can introduce targeting ligands, labels, drugs, combination of drugs. You have to work on the shielding, like last talk told us. And all is based on a polymeric scaffold, and this has some advantages which are listed here and may direct to precision medicine. Our strategy in Jena is to do polymer libraries as the basis, so we can, by choosing the monomers, basically, we can enter the combination of monomers, we can influence the parameter space in a wide range, so we can introduce hydrophilicity, degradability, charge, or not. And we have additionally the possibility to put on targeting ligands on the alpha or omega end groups. We can put on dyes or drugs. What we're also working on is a whole bunch of new and also well-known monomers, which are all polymerized in a living fashion, the controlled polymerizations. And where we really well equipped is the characterization as well, characterization methods as well for the polymers, but also for the particles, starting from two-dimensional methods, SEC, HPLC, up to very special methods, TERS, Raman scattering on the surfaces to detect orientation, for instance, of targeting molecules on the surface of nanoparticles. We do design for this. We start from block gradient large and small polymers. We do libraries. We formulate different libraries of nanoparticles, thereby influencing size, charge, surface architecture, combined with a rigorous characterization and also with modeling, for instance, compatibility of drugs with certain polymers in the core of nanoparticles to increase encapsulation efficiencies for certain drug molecules. So it's also with some theoretical background on that. Of course, then the biological readout hopefully leads us to the elucidation of quantitative structure property relationships. And after some feedback loops, we hope to get multifunctional cell and organ-specific particles, and in our special case, for applications to inflammation-related diseases. Okay, since I'm here in a session for cancer therapy, I kicked out some slides from Professor Schubert and want to show you two examples, polymeric examples for cancer therapy, and maybe focus you on a quite new target on cell surfaces, which is the CLUT5 protein. It's a transport protein which is very much selective for D-fructose, and which is overexpressed in a lot of breast cancer cells. The structure has been shown or elucidated in 2015, and since the first publication together with Martina Stenzel in Sydney in 2014, now quite a few of publications appeared which show that fructose conjugated polymers and in particular nanostructures show selectivity to be taken up into breast cancer cell lines, and in particular also into breast cancer cell lines which are so-called triple negative breast cancer cell lines, so which do not have, for instance, the HER2 receptor expressed. And I picked up two examples. First example is based on cationic polymers, or tries to use cationic polymers for gene transfection. And of course, there has been a lot of work done in the development of gene delivery vectors. You all know the viral vectors, but for polymer chemists, more the non-viral vectors are more interesting, in particular the cationic polymers and the gold standard. Hope this has shifted a bit. Gold standard here is polyethylenamine. The structure is shown here. It forms stable polyplexes with high buffer capacity. It has easy to functionalize, but it has some drawbacks. Sorry for the, I don't know why the computer shifted that. Has, of course, some drawbacks. As you know, it has a high cytotoxicity. It's non-specific, and the polyplexes like to aggregate. That's why we thought, okay, why not functionalize with D-fructose? And here, schematically only drawn the ways to one of the fructose functionalized polymers. So we took a linear polyethylenamine, introduced some double bonds to a certain extent. The extent is very much important. And we conjugated fructose via a small linker, thiolene click reaction, and deprotected finally the fructose. And if you look at polyethylenamine, here you see the are three cell lines, L929 and a human cell line, and a triple negative breast cancer cell line. And you see, as I mentioned before, the L-pi itself already at low concentrations kills more or less everything of the cell population. If you look now at the fructose functionalized polymers, we were very surprised because this example here, for instance, it doesn't kill any of the human cell lines or the mouse fibroblasts, but it selectively kills the breast cancer cells. So we had introduced, just by attaching a few molecules of fructose, a quite selective toxicity. We looked also at the hemolytic activity of these polymers. Nicely seen here that L-pi itself has a quite hemolytic effect also already at low concentrations, where as the pi conjugated with fructose shows a very nicely reduced hemolytic activity. So we introduced also some hemocompatibility to that. And if you formulate polyplexes with pDNA here shown with the L-pi, then doesn't matter which NP ratio you use, L-pi gets more or less, or the polyplexes made of L-pi and pDNA get more or less uptaken in all of these cell lines. If you look at the polyplexes which we formulated with the fructose functionalized L-pi, we see a nice specificity for the breast cancer cells. So we had a specific uptake of polyplexes in this case. A transfection we could not see with this polymer. We are still working on different molecular weights, different ratios, and also branch price to get siRNA efficiently in also released into the cells. The second example maybe we established was to use this a fructose, commercially available fructose derivative as initiator for the polymerization of ethylene oxide. So we can in this way get the every chain functionalized at the beginning with a fructose and an OH at the end, and then we can do a chain extension with some hydrophobic polyether segment and end up in quite a library here, shown only three polymers with different chain lengths of the hydrophilic and the hydrophobic segments. And depending on this block length, we see formation of different types of micelles. So from normal spherical micelles up to worm-like micelles, in most cases also mixtures of both. And also here, if you look at the uptake of these micelles, we see the most pronounced uptake of the fructose, functionalized fructose-carrying micelles, with a certain content of worm-like micelles into breast cancer cell lines. With this, I'm at the end. I think I made up some time and showed you two examples where we develop new polymers into the direction of also cancer therapy, but this is only a side. I always tell my hobby science, it's just a side field of interest in Jena. Many of the people there go now for this inflammatory, inflammation-related diseases. At the end, I want to thank Uli Schubert and the Schubert Group, as well as Professor Schacher and Martina Stenzel, and the PhD students who worked on this fructose-conjugated polymers, and the funding agencies, and you for your attention. Thank you.
So thank you very much. First time for a question, for one or two short questions. Could you press?
Thank you for the nice presentation. Do you have in vivo?
Please a bit louder.
Thank you for the nice presentation. Do you have any in vivo data with your fructose functionalized polyethylenamine?
We are working on that currently. They are under investigation in Munich. So far, I do not have any in vivo data. There are two papers out now, end of last year, where they showed that fructose-substituted micelles are also accumulated in the respective xenograft mice models. For my polyethylenamine, I do not have any data yet.
Okay, then I should say, I also have a short question. This is, of course, if you modify your polyethylenamine, you convert a lot of amine groups, which are basic, into esters and into amides. Mm-hmm. When you compare the system, does it have a comparable theta potential?
No, theta potential gets smaller, so not so positive anymore.
Could this explain most of changes in specificity of uptake, or is there some special effects of sugar units?
We have also the same polymer, just conjugated with thiol glucose and thiol galactose, and they are not taken up into that into the breast cancer cell lines.
Okay.
So we did also negative control.
So thank you very much again for the presentation, and I want to close the session so that we have chance to get another coffee.